said, welcome to the stream. Welcome back. Perhaps it's possibly time. I guess I don't want to commit to anything or make any promises, but we could be at the end of this game. Final Fantasy 16, we did some last night, made some decent progress, destroyed the last Mother Crystal, and then old what's-his-face, Ultima, he dragged us into some shadow realm of sorts and said that, he divulged a lot of information, let me just put it that way. And time is a flat circle, history repeats itself, his race is was going through the same thing that the human race is going through now, basically. And, he wants Clive as that mythos, as he put it. So, he said something like, come on down to Genesis, we'll settle this there. And a brand new crystal popped up, I think, in Twinside. So, with that, there was a bunch of side quests, other things that had popped up, and it led to a lot of side time for me to go through and kind of work some of these out. Boy, there was a lot of them. It took like 3 hours to get through all of the side quests and everything. And also, some of the hunt stuff I was able to go through as well. In fact, I think I did all of them. At least I did the important ones. And the important ones were what mattered because that was what gets me the materials to make what's potentially the best weapon in the game. We shall see, but let's go ahead and get on into it.
It's showtime.
And we'll see where we're at. I think we're pretty close to the end. Just going based off of where the stories hit up and sort of the pacing and things that have seemed to be coming to conclusion here. I know I think I said last time that it seemed like we wrapped up all the side characters' plot lines and stuff with some of the side quests I did off stream. But in fact, there were still more, and characters I wasn't even thinking of that had some side quests this time around, including Joshua and Mid and some other people. There was actually some nice ones. I will say that the side quests that have things to do with actual characters and not just miscellaneous NPCs are a little bit more satisfying. It seems like they put a little bit more effort into them. You know, there's actually some cutscenes and stuff that tie into them. Nothing terribly major. Mid was trying to build a model of a little airship. That one was kind of disappointing, I gotta say. She was like, if I could just get this model to work, maybe we could build it up at a larger scale and create something that'll help us to fly. You go and get all these pieces for her, and it doesn't work. And she's like, well, maybe we're not supposed to fly. And she's like, as soon as you send people up, you know, into the air, then they're just going to start raining terror down on people. And I was like, well, that's technology in a nutshell. It could always be used for ill-gotten purposes, but sort of the risk you have to take with progress. But it wasn't meant to be, I suppose. We did some stuff with Karen. Went to find some more. I think initially it started as, like, more bones for Torgal. I'd mentioned that one where you have to go, like, find some femur bones for him to make him happy. But initially I think it started out as that, and then Torgal ended up taking us to a little trip down to some hideaway spot that was near Rosaria. And he was always searching for Clive and had a little storehouse of little keepsakes and whatnot. We'll go take a look before we make off anywhere at the treasures that Clive has accumulated. And maybe it will refresh my memory as to what we've seen.
Oh, would it be?
But I did, in fact, get all the materials. It looks like it's ready to roll for the Goddamarung. If Ragnarok was forged to mark the War of the Gods, then Goddamarung, meaning Twilight of the Gods, was forged to mark the fall of those selfsame deities. All right. Takes a dark steel, primitive battle horn, which was a hunt that I had done prior. Dark steel. There was a couple interesting bosses. Most of them weren't too unique. In fact, the one I think that was like the most unique actually didn't have any sort of material I needed. It was weird. But basically we fought a King Behemoth. That's what it was. And then we fought Thanatos, the Grim Reaper, which was basically a, what was it? I forget what they're called. They're maybe like wraiths or something. They're one of the fallen type enemies. So the one that acts more like a mid-boss. And it's kind of skinny and floats around. Fought one of those. And those two were the ones that had the materials that we needed. But the one that was actually unique was weird. Gizmoluk makes a return. I forget if it was in any other Final Fantasies aside from 9, but it definitely was in 9 because there was that Gizmoluk's Grotto where you have the first like party split up and you have to go through that little section there. Very different type of enemy. This one seemed more air element based as opposed to water based like in Final Fantasy 9, but it had some unique attacks, so it's kind of interesting. Anyway, let's craft this thing. Item equipped. No no nonsense. It's like you want this one equipped, I suppose. It doesn't look like, yeah. Same with every other legendary type weapon that we've crafted. No anything chance else of upgrading it. Well, I mean, kind of sort of anticlimactic. I was saving it just in case there was a cutscene tied to it. It doesn't seem too different from the Ragnarok, aside from the blade being more silver. I think maybe that little inlet there has an orange hue to it. But other than that, it looks the same. All right, well, that's fine. It'll do more damage, I suppose. All right, these are all the treasures, I think. I think that's everything. Oh, no, it isn't. Okay, well, there's one side quest that I did leave, just in case I had something important, so maybe we'll get something out of that, but it looks like there's 4 more things. But let's see, we've got the Oath, we already saw that before. The Hanged Man signboard, emblem of the Hanged Man, a tavern that sits in the heart of Lostwing, now in the depths of an Aether flood. Depicts a hooded, bound, and starved man hung by the ankles, perhaps contemplating how he will take his vengeance on those who made him this way. Now that Quentin strives to build a new future for the remnants of his Lostwing family, mayhap the Hanged Man will rise again, but likely under a different name. That one, Lostwing Quentin was a guy in the apron, had a bit of a bad attitude about him. Very stern man. But that whole area got Aether flooded, and a lot of the people died there going on some quest of vengeance for Quentin. But they decided to rebuild. Martha's Rest signboard. Emblem of Martha's Rest, personal fiefdom, the landlady of the Golden Stables, an island of safety and security in a sea of anything but. Shows a sleeping chocobo, and the guardians and bearers of Rosaria can too rest easy, safe the knowledge that they have a friend in Martha. I don't think there was anything special about that particular spot. I don't even remember how we, like, wrapped up things there, but we did. The Vale signboard, emblem of the Vale, Northreach's far-famed house of ill repute. Town is the getaway to the imperial capital, Oriflamme, where waves of old money and new lap against the opposing sides of the Great Wall. However, the Vale's proprietor, Isabel, knows that it best... Isabel knows it best as a safe haven in a storm. There you go. Town that took her in, and the man she loved when the rest of the world shunned them. I don't really remember what happened with that one. That was the side quest we did that was the under new management one. Something about, like, somebody taking over that town. I forget. Guardian's scarf, the tippet dyed red with the flames of the Firebird and the blood of his fallen Rosarian brothers, does Sir Wade pledge not only his loyalty, but the loyalty of the Guardians of the Flame. Wrapped up something with him, I forget. Briar's Kiss signboard, emblem of the Briar's Kiss, finest forge in Dalamil, run by the puckish and precocious young forge master, Lubor. This was tied to our own blacksmith here. He inherited both the forge and the role of Desert Hare from his predecessor, the original Ruzina Dalamil, through the mayoralty of Dalamil. He won entirely by his own merits. The Crimson Caravan signboard. Emblem of the Crimson Caravans, porters of the wide-renowned base in the market of the town of Bokled, depicts a laden chocobo after the death of her brother and confidant Theodore. That was his name. Theodore and Eloise, those are the two. Eloise chose to continue the work they had begun together, freeing bearers from slavery, just as she had freed him so many years before. Yeah, she sent him on some quest to go slay some dragon. The place ended up being Aether flooded, and he turned. It was probably the most depressing of the side quests, I should say, but that's how it goes sometimes. Clay Hearth signboard. The emblem of the Undying headquarters in Tabor. The Undying are a secret society sworn to serve House Rosfield and more particularly the dominance of the Phoenix that are boarded to the Rosfield line, such as their acolytes' faith in the Phoenix. They will gladly surrender their lives if it should be for the benefit of their master. We're going to be wrapping up this side quest. I'm going to go check it out. Basically, there was some letter that was left from Clive and Joshua's father to them, and it was basically some kind of will that said that he would like to see all of the bearers emancipated after he finishes his business at the Phoenix Gate or whatever. So that never came to pass, but the will is carried on, I guess, so to speak. That quest line is going to end with them visiting their father's grave, so we're going to do that before we head out to the Genesis area. Sid's Goblet, we already saw that one. This is the model airship I was talking about. Mid's dangerous dream of flight, immortalized in miniature. The experiment ended in failure. Mid has allowed, quote-unquote, Clive to keep hold of the model so that once her renown is grown, he might sell the piece for an exorbitant amount of gil. Hey, Be Forgotten, welcome in. Hello, how are you doing? We have the Triunity Accord, signed in Port Isolde by representatives from Rosaria, Dalmechia, and Sambrec. This mutual accord sets a stage for a new age in Storm, if not officially, then at least in the spirit. Uncle Byron, some of the other political officials, basically everybody that's still remaining that has some sort of pull, all came together and said, you know what, after the whole Ultima thing, if we're all still living, maybe we can come together after all this is said and done. We have a Stolas Quill, Lorsman Hippocrates' best-loved writing implement, whose ink has penned many a learned tome. He said that the long quills of the Stolas became imbued with the wishes it hears over a long lifetime. Words just waiting to pour out onto a page. So should the day come that Clive puts down his sword and picks up the pen, he shall not find his one and only insurmountable enemy in writer's block. Scholar's Bonnet. I forget what we did for the quill, actually. I think we had to go get a flower that, Hippocrates had given to Dion. It was that flower that Dion was always carrying around, but it was purple, so it had some kind of significance to it. Scholar's Bonnet, Viviet Ninetales, academic cap, awarded to her upon her graduation from the University of Canver. Now Vivian shares her learning with Clive, gifted the bonnet serving as a pledge that so long as they remain together, her knowledge shall be as much his as it is her own. I don't remember. We went to go get some kind of book for her, basically. Some of these were boiled down to very basic things. Again, most of the side quests were just go get item and deliver item to person. So, not the most exciting. Winter Mead, a gift from Gav, potable, was made of honey collected from the Northern Territory's short summers and fermented slowly over the next 6 moons. Despite Navi's inability to hold his drink, Gav has insisted that he be allowed to share the bottle when the time comes to crack the seal. I think Gav... Oh god, there was a pregnant girl, and I was kind of like not paying attention. I don't know if it was the girl that they had got from, Balud. The one that was remaining in the town. Gav was the one that escorted her back to the hideaway, so it's possible that they hooked up, but... Yeah, anyway, he was like hooking up with some pregnant girl, so I don't know if it was her or someone else. Continental Censor, ornate brass censor from beyond the outer seas, gifted Clive by Karen for his assistance clearing her name. According to the Cantankerous Shopkeep, when packed with herbs and ambergris left to smolder, the fragrant smoke produced can ward off everything from insects to the plague, protect a home from thieves and demons, and heal any number of ailments, all while bringing love and fortune. I don't really remember what we did for Karen. We went and got something for her. Of the Martell apples, somewhat stunted, somewhat sweet apple grown from the blighted earth, thanks to the dedication of perseverance of one woman, Martell. Though she was to lose her life in the wound she sustained in Kupka's attack on the hideaway, her legacy lives on in the sapling she saved from the ruins. That was from a while ago, I think. So was this one, Ambrosia's Tack. We never looked at it, though. Saddle and blinders crafted specifically for Clive's childhood chocobo, Ambrosia. Even after being separated from her master, the noble steed served the people of Rosaria in his stead, protecting the defenseless from the merciless, just as a good shield should. We got that, of course, when we got the chocobo. But that was a while ago. And the charred sparring sword, Clive's old sparring sword, salvaged by Torgal in the aftermath of the Ironblood's invasion and hidden at Clive's original hideaway, the Rookery. It is a reminder of who Clive once was and who he has become, as well as the unbreakable bond between lifelong friends. And that's all of it. That's a shitload of stuff. And apparently there's still four more to get, but I at least wanted to go over those because it's racked up over a while. The sword was the one I was talking about with Torgel and how he was going back to Phoenix Gate and procuring items that were like keepsakes of the soldiers and Clive there and taking them back to Clive's old hiding spot, I guess, the Rookery. But with all that said and done, we are done with all the available side quests. I don't know if I ended up missing some, or maybe there's some post-game stuff, perhaps. But I'm not too sure where those last four items come in. In any case, we're going to wrap up that one quest I mentioned.
Unwavering will and an unbreakable bond. Do you really think we're strong enough?
Save the world? Of course. To have overcome Father's political enemies. Of that, I'm less certain. Especially knowing what we know now. What Mother was truly capable of. But perhaps these bands would have helped. Knowing he was with us would have made all the difference.
It's just back there.
I've actually come here before. I thought it looked a little bit odd, but I wasn't sure what it was, or if there was something here to do. Oh yeah, there was. I guess it ended up being a tombstone. I wasn't sure if it was like a marker or what.
Father always fought for what he believed was right. It wasn't until that night at Phoenix Gate that I realized I had never fought for anything. I always had someone else to do the fighting for me.
Yeah, he was like 9 or something.
No matter how fate conspired against him, he never lost heart, never looked back, never stopped fighting. To me, he was the greatest of men. And I've been trying to live up to his ideals ever since.
We all have, Clive. We all have. And we'll keep trying. Because that's what he would have wanted.
What he would have done himself. Even if it meant standing against the very gods in the heavens.
I shall be borrowing this, Father, if I may. That you might watch over us as we follow in your footsteps.
Oh my god, a ghost.
We won't lay you down.
Onward then.
He's still alive.
Onward. To the end.
And to the end.
Beginning.
Well, let's not get ahead of ourselves. So, yeah, I figured it probably was a little bit more pertinent than some of the other stuff that we've done. Rusted battle helm, Archduke Elwyn's helm worn during his victorious campaign to quell the Northern Uprising. War is coming, my boy. You must make ready, Archduke Elwyn. So, let's keepsake that will be with the rest of the items that we just saw. Joining hands with Joshua. Joshua has joined Clive's party and will remain with him until departing for Origin. Oh, good. Because that's about where we're going to go now. Oh, there's a side quest that popped up. Son of a bitch. Well, let's make for here, see who it is. If it's like an actual character, I might consider doing it. If it's just like some random NPC, then maybe not. Something at the reading table. But as I said, that quest started with a letter that was meant to be delivered to, I think, either Joshua or Clive. Probably more Joshua, more so Joshua. Since Clive was just kind of like the shunned child. But I was talking about him wanting to emancipate the bearers and all that. Archduke Elwyn's helm, worn victorious campaign to quell the Northern Uprising, later laid to rest upon his memorial stone. Now it sleeps in Clive's chambers, constant reminder of the bravery and selflessness of man in whose footsteps he and his brother mean to follow. Should have known. Something for Jill. Well, she's somewhat important, right? Actually, I guess this is more fulfillment for Joshua. Though her icon brought her much suffering, the loss of Shiva weighs heavy on her heart, and we would be poor friends indeed if we did not seek to lighten the burden. Even but only a fraction before we depart for the skies, I would speak on this more in private. All right, fair enough.
If Joshua was worried about Jill, I should go and speak with him.
We can do just that. I wonder if, like, this will set off a chain of side quests, because, again, there were, well, I guess three spots missing now. Depending on how long it takes, I don't know. Sometimes these side quests can have you, like, running around for a while. Like I said, I did a lot of them, though. There was, like, 12 that were available. Maybe even a little bit more.
Joshua, I read your message. You're right. Jill is different. I don't think I'd realized how different, but since we've returned from Drake's spine, I've felt it more and more.
I suppose it's not hard to imagine why.
She doesn't think she belongs anymore.
And that's why we need to remind her she is still one of us. To let her know that we still need her, now more than ever. That you still need her. But how to do that? When last we were truly close, we were but children.
Of course. Do you remember the time we accompanied Father on his annual tour of the duchy? And Jill and I broke from the procession to ride up Man's Hill.
To see the snow daisies, I remember. It was the first time Father had allowed us to join him. And when he realized you were missing, he had the entire retinue down to the pot boys combing the countryside.
In the rain. A thunderstorm forced us to take refuge in a grove of oaks before we'd even made it halfway there. It was the Lord Commander who finally found us, and needless to say, he was none too pleased.
Then it seems you and Jill have unfinished business. What do you say?
Man's Hill. It's not that far.
Oh, true. Though I suspect it is also much changed. Little in Southern Rosaria remains as it was when we were children.
You're saying I should go and scout the area for bandits?
I'm saying we should first go and see if there are actually still any snow daisies left. What would you do without me, Clive?
Good point. Alright, let's see. Man's Hill. Seems like it's not terribly far removed from the entryway here, so that's good. There are a couple. Oh, hey, I was just looking at the trophies. I think that's the one to clear the map.
This is the place, but...
Or visit every area on the map.
I'm sorry, Clive.
There's no weapon spared. What do we do now?
We keep looking. Man's Hill cannot be the only place where snow daisies grow.
Perhaps, but it's the only place I know of. knew of.
Then why not ask someone who might know of another?
Someone at the backyard? To the hideaway, then.
We just came from there. All right.
Let's hope one of the gardeners knows where to find snow daisies.
Oh. I was looking at that quest marker. I'm like, where the hell does that lead? I forget that I rarely visit down there anyway, but I forget that the growing facilities.
Say what you will.
I don't know if they want to call it an arbor or what. They're a little bit beneath the rest of the areas over here. I remember doing a side quest for this the time before the last stream. So this looks a little bit different, but they're actually able to grow stuff here. But this...
Without sun, these leaves
getting all this stuff to grow and bear fruit or whatever. Up to the ability of the potions.
Down from the heavens, Sid.
I need your advice. Joshua and I are looking for a place where snow daisies grow. Preferably in abundance.
Snow daisies. Then you'll want somewhere not too hot and not too cold. And where the winds are strong enough to carry the seeds. I reckon Man's Hill would be a good place to start. There in the Royal Meadows, perhaps? Both have similar climbs and the right elevation. If the Blight hasn't claimed them yet.
Right. Thank you.
Did you learn where we might find our flowers?
The gardener here mentioned the Royal Meadows in Sambrek.
The fields beyond Northreach. Well, if that's the case, then Yote was right. I recall that she kept the record of our travels, you see. So I asked her if she'd perhaps noted anywhere that snow daisies grew, and she mentioned Oilefeist Bay.
Whose shores border the meadows. Off we go, then.
Got no idea where that is, but okay. I'm sure they do. Hold up a sec. I suppose if it's got a spot of the spire, it's not like I could move any closer, but before I actually get there, I guess I suppose I like to see whereabouts they're sending me. It was kind of up in this area, near one of the watchtowers. I think I had ventured up there before on a stream, but there's not really a whole lot going there. Typical with the watchtowers, a bunch of guards come out and you fight them. But that's where we fought Thanatos. Was an interesting battle. Actually, that was one of the harder ones. It wasn't the hardest, but I'd say of all the marks, that one got a little bit tricky, and then the King Behemoth was probably the worst.
Where do we even start?
Yote mentioned the coastline. We can start there.
Which, after the fact, there were a number of Behemoths that were part of the marks. One of them was tied in pretty heavily with one of the side quests. So.
See them?
I do. Ours and our friends.
Let darkness move.
My only problem. Okay. That's good. I almost forgot I had that ability. The Garuda can grab smaller enemies out of the air.
What do you see, boy?
I had switched out an ability for the Odin thing so I could try that Zantetsuken, which actually isn't terribly bad. It's kind of cool, but it yeah. Takes out the Phoenix thing, which means I can't dash towards enemies. Maybe we could give it a try here in a second, the Zentetsuken. Oh shit. It looked like he was gonna charge, it, like stopped for a second. This ability, this like dancing blades or whatever, freezes enemies entirely so that you can charge Zentetsuken Cage by doing these combos like that, so that's pretty nice. I dig that. And then level 5 is as high as it gets. Okay, so here's Zentetsuken. Does an ass load of damage. I can't complain about that. Faffing about a bit when it came to some of those abilities, but still did a decent amount, especially with that Mega Flare. I gotta get used to a couple different things. I did make some sort of adjustments to my loadout. I no longer have... Oh, we got a Minotaur main. Main using everything from Helmcrest to hairbrushes, primarily by those people lucky enough to have ever met a Minotaur. And loaded Sir Crandall strike the main from the beast and rob him of his strength from the noble knight.
That was harder than I expected.
But I no longer have the precision dodge power up, so I don't get those flame attacks. But I got a new item that
it was worth it.
Just buffs every attack by, I think, 5%. So I figured it'd be worth the trade-off.
Do you think Jill will like them?
She'll love them. Come on. Let's go.
Because to be quite honest, I'm not too sure how much of a boost I got from that item that did the precision dodge attack boost. I don't think it had any numerical value to it, and I wasn't, like, keeping track of the data to see, you know, what the difference was between damage with and without it. So, I figure something that just boosts all damage across the board would be better than just one that boosts it for a short amount of time.
It's up to you. Well, you and the skies. We wouldn't want another thunderstorm now, would we?
Where does Jill hang out, even? Where is that? Clive's chambers, I suppose. I don't see too much of her, at least not with the last few streams we've done.
Jill. There's something I'd like to show you.
There is? And where might this something be?
It's, not here. Now, I know this is sudden, but how would you fancy a trip to Auriflam?
Okay. Didn't even need to say anything. I should just start following. Kind of surprised that castle's still standing in the background.
This is what you wanted to show me. I don't know what to say.
Is that a good thing or a bad thing?
You don't need to say anything. The smile on your face is enough. We've been worried about you, Joshua and I. Do you remember when I took you to Man's Hill? Or tried to?
How could I forget? You saw me crying and thought a change of scenery might lift my spirits. In the end, it earned me a nasty cough and a stern scolding from your mother. But I felt wonderful nonetheless.
I'm sorry. I had no idea what I was getting us both into. But I couldn't bear to see you like that.
Before we left, my chambermaid told me she'd overheard your mother talking about my marriage prospects with some of the noblewomen at court. They were debating whether it would be more profitable to marry me off to one of the high houses instead of saving me for the ducal line. No one thought to ask me what I wanted. I was nothing to them. A pawn at best. I felt so trapped. So lonely.
I didn't know.
But I wasn't alone. You were there. Your hand in mine as we ran for those oaks. And I knew then, no matter what happened, I would be all right. I'll never forget that feeling.
Torgal just asleep. Didn't want nothing to do with this.
Before we broke camp, the morning after the storm, do you know what I did?
No. What?
I slipped away from my governess to climb the Tor. And from there, I saw a sea of petals, all reaching for the sun. And I realized no matter how terrible the night, dawn would always come. That you would always come for me. And you have. Again and again.
In more ways than one.
Where do you see us? When all this is over?
I don't know. Not here, though. I think I've outgrown the twins. After everything we've been through, the realm just seems so small. I'll need some space to spread my wings.
Then that's what you'll have. And I'll stop at nothing to see that you do.
Much good at garlands, but it'll have to do.
I'll treasure it forever.
Thank you, Clive, for this, the flowers, for everything. It's exactly what I needed. You are my treasure.
Touching moments, I suppose. Hey, what the hell is that out there?
We should probably be getting back. I expect the others are wondering where we are.
You're right. There's still much to do.
And we'll do it together.
Hopefully not too much. I'm looking at finishing up tonight. There's like a big old crystal in the distance. I don't know what that was. I thought all the crystal stuff was gone. We got Shiva's Kiss reduces Diamond Dust cooldown time by 7.5 seconds. And Snow Daisy Garland. Fragrant diadem, handwoven by Jill from flowers picked on the shores of Oilfice Bay, maybe? I never was too much good at garlands, but it'll have to do. The words she just said. Jill has joined Clive's party and remain with him until departing for Origin. Now, wait a second. Do we get Joshua as well? Oh, no. Joshua just left. But the game said he was going to be with us until Origin. We've got no party switching system. Oh, that was another thing I was going to check, too. There were those two items I don't have, but no additional side quests pulled up. So I don't know where the hell you get those from unless it's like stuff. So, I mean, so far, you would have to go think it would go in line with the rest of the items that we acquired.
How are you doing? Here you go.
Which means that they are procured by accomplishing certain side quests.
Always something in there.
Except for right now, obviously, because there's nothing in there. But anyway. Yeah, whatever it is. I'm guessing it's probably going to be like post-main game, or I suppose too. After getting up to Origin, it's possible that there's going to be another break, and we'll have some time to knock out a couple more side quests, perhaps. However, I mean, it seems pretty finalima. We've gotten the ultimate weapon. We've gotten all of the hunts taken care of. It seems like, you know, we've wrapped it up just about as much as we can with the side quests. I don't imagine what we would be able to do, because every side character that I could think of has, you know, had some sort of conclusion. But anyway, we'll make for Origin. See what happens. What? What's he gonna do while he's at it?
Clive, if you see me dad up there, tell him you were right to leave his legacy with you.
Tell him he'll be in the front row. There's no way he'd miss this. Well, behave yourself, Mid.
We'll see.
So, you're in charge now, Gav.
And what does Taya have to say about that? Come back before she finds out, eh?
Kind of weird to figure Otto with all he's doing. I guess he is a little bit on the older side, though. Easy there, Gav.
Thank you, Yote. I'm sorry.
Your Grace, I shall pray for your safe return.
That's kind of you.
But you should pray he took his medicine. I didn't spend all night grinding herbs for his lordship to leave them on his nightstand. Again.
You needn't fear, Lady Tyre. And thank you.
See that your brother comes back in one piece. Or, at most, two. Any more and you can heal him yourself.
I'll keep that in mind.
Well, there's nothing to say that hasn't already been said. But that's never stopped me before, so just you do what needs doing. And don't worry about us.
We'll do our best, Uncle.
That'll be well.
If that is all? Not quite. Jill.
It's time, isn't it?
It is. Take care of him. And you. You take care of her too, boy.
Don't forget, Clive. We all choose our own path. Believe in yours. I do.
I'll be back. I promise. I love you, Jill.
Everybody's acting like it's the last time they'll see each other. I don't know. I guess it's a just-in-case kind of thing.
I know. I love you, too.
To kill.
No, he did it. Was it the first time he was going to try that out? It was gonna be one of those things where like they were pressed into a corner and then he's like, oh, gonna give it a try, and then Bahamut comes out, but no, they'll just fly there from the start. Because as we disclosed previously, you know, it was like, well, you took my power, Clive, but other people have been able to transform back into their icons, and they're like, oh, well, you know, they weren't themselves, though. And he's like, oh, I'll just have to be better than they were. And I guess he was.
Here they come. Hold on, Joshua!
Already am.
Battle begins. Yes, it does. All the little fighters coming out in action.
He's going to make us a way in.
Keep up, or they got vaporized with the rest of the stuff.
So, this is Origin.
Far cry from heaven.
Where it all began. Where it all begins. Our Ark. Your architect.
There you are.
It was here that we slumbered. Here that we waited for centuries, clinging to our decrepit shell, for fear that we might have need of it once again. But you have come at last. And now we shall be truly complete.
Well?
There's three of us, and one of him. Let's make it count.
Don't do anything too crazy. At least not right off the bat. Zero. That's not fun. Why do we have to share, all three of us share one life bar? Is that a dark Ifrit? Well, we had seen during the last stream that was what his old physical form was. Which is why he called it a decrepit form here. Because Ultima, the weird guy with the, you know, forearms and the white hair that we've seen, that's just kind of more like the spirit energy form. But his true form was a little bit more resembling of Ifrit. Seems to be a bit of a one-winged angel, though. Kind of weird that it's got, like, the one big wing. I've not done a thing except for press the square button, like, 3 times. And I've lost half the health bar. This could just be a cutscene. We don't have to pretend. No pretenses here. Wonder if it's going to be that Tetraflare move. Usually a pretty big attack in the Final Fantasy games. Oh, try Disaster. I don't think that's the first time that's popped up either. Ultima Prime thwarted. Well, it was a big move.
And you only surrender. This unpleasantness could have been avoided.
No, I don't think that's it. If it was, it would feel a little bit like a rip-off.
Clive! Clive! No! Did I mention you look terrible?
That leaves two of us.
I was about to say, what about you?
And Dion. Take my hand.
No, I told you, I'll be...
Come on.
Thank you.
Press on.
Always.
Alright. Doubt there's gonna be anything to explore, right? I can't even turn around. We are strictly pressing forward.
I'm sorry about Dion.
Don't be. Please. He did what he had to do.
And it's time we did the same. Should we stop?
Because of a cough. No, I think we're past that, Clive.
I suppose we are.
I don't know if it was ever discussed in, like, maybe the lore thing. They touched on it a bit in some of the cutscenes and such.
So cold. So empty. We're close.
But that chest cavity on Joshua... It was my understanding that he was containing some aspect of Ultima.
Then think instead of those waiting for us at home.
But I have to wonder to what extent, or if it was even that. But that's how it came across when they discussed it, when they were talking about his condition. But I'm wondering if he could just... Can he not just let that go for right now? Maybe it's just accumulated too much over time, or that's just the damage done.
Clive.
They can't be.
But they are. This is the Nexus. A wellspring of life. Yours and ours. As you watch the world stumble slowly to its dark end, it was here we pledged a new beginning. And now, with the ether we have harvested, I shall raise my kin from their eternal slumber. That together, we may usher in a new age of reason.
This was never about creation, only self-preservation. You condemned an entire world so that you alone might escape death.
Alone. Him. Alone. Life. I think I understand. He...
He what?
Oh no.
They sacrificed their flesh to become beating hearts of crystal that pumped the land's lifeblood from the depths of the earth unto this very chamber. And thus would they labor still, long after their work was done, had you not set them free.
You meant for us to destroy the Mother Crystals. It's what you wanted all along.
You have our gratitude, Newthos. In this, you have served us well. You have both served us well.
To be fair, I kind of figured that's what was going to happen.
Welcome home, brother.
Although, without destroying the Mother Crystals, I still would have been pumping that aether, so... Seems like kind of a damned if you do, damned if you don't situation.
I thought... it was me. But it wasn't my grasp that grew weaker. It was theirs that grew stronger.
Joshua! No!
Okay, well, I guess that kind of answers that about the chest cavity thing.
And now, we can become one.
Healing flames of the Phoenix. This, I once believed, would be Ultima's true form. But I was wrong. I see it now. Why you will never become Ultima's vessel.
I don't care. Just hold on.
Listen to me, Clive. You remember the murals? People once knew that Ultima was their god. That he created them. And they worshipped him, prayed to him, looked to him for guidance. In vain. In vain. For he did not listen, did not acknowledge our will. And so we strayed from his path to forge one of our own. So absorbed was he in his own desires, so driven by his own will alone, that he shunned the one thing that could have made him truly powerful. Faith. The same faith people now place in you. Faith that you will fulfill their dream, Sid's dream, of creating a better world for us. Faith that you will follow in Father's footsteps and save those who need saving most. Faith that you will answer Jill's plea to save yourself. The difference is, Clive, that you chose to listen, and that is what has steeled our bonds. Bonds that helped you stand firm when Ultima's pull was at its strongest. His power may be absolute, but so is ours. And so will yours be. With my light in your heart, not even a god might stop us.
Joshua! Don't do it, you're...
Enough, Clive. My body is too far gone. If the wound does not take me, the curse will.
Look at me, Joshua. Open your eyes! Open your eyes, damn you!
Why? Why did you do this? Joshua!
And thus does the final piece fall into place. The incantation primed. But one task remains. To empty the vessel.
So Ultima looks a little bit more presentable now. Not quite as sickly as he was looking before. Did he looked weird. Like, I know he's supposed to be, but he looked like he was diseased or something. So now they keep calling him a deity and a god and all that kind of stuff. Now he kind of more looks the part as opposed to some rotting corpse.
Still here. With me to the end.
Even now, you would deny the inevitable.
Get those feet out of my face.
That's what you always have. And always will.
Alright, Clive, get that goddamn arong out.
On this, my sword, I swear,
to shield the Firebird's flame forevermore.
May not be the best of magic caster of all, but there's a couple things I could do here and there. Spell. Right, the God Dammerung. That's the Goddard Dammerung. Or whatever, but it sounds like goddamn, so might as well make use of it. The Titan block. It'll probably help with getting the stagger gauge down, but he warps around so goddamn much. Let's see if we get something ready for Xanthatsukan. It's not even gonna give me a level 4, I don't think. Shit. That's alright. We can probably build it up pretty far.
Countless centuries have I waited for this moment. This moment in which I might revel in my creation. Only to find it profaned, and so it must be cleansed.
I was gonna jump into the icon portion of the battle. If we even get to one, but I'm sure we will.
Your will yet endures.
Because it's not so easily broken.
But it can be broken. And I shall see it so. For such is my will.
Try it.
That's the area of effect. Yeah, I'm not really sure how I'm supposed to get out of that, but alright. Back to that. Unfortunately, when you're trying to charge a Xanthatsukan, your damage suffers pretty bad, so I don't like using that, except just charge it to the limit, and that's about it. When you read the description, they make it sound like it's supposed to boost your attack or something, but it's really only good for the charging. I don't know if that's just because of a weapon thing or what. It essentially switches out your weapon for Odin's Blade, but like I said, the way they make it sound, it almost sounds like it's supposed to, you know, be an addition to your weapon, so you'd almost feel like it would be an attack boost and not necessarily something that just overrides whatever blade you're currently using. Oh shit, I'm still on the line. Hey, Prelaw. Thank you for stopping in. Dash towards him. Get away from that. Smite. Primed and ready to go. Actually, that is pretty far down on his health. Probably didn't even need to use Mega Flare.
What latent force feeds these flames? I sense more here than mere will. Is this Logos? Have you truly become free?
Yeah, the ultimate logo rests within him.
No, I forbid it. You are not a god. You are but flesh and bone. You are not one of us.
And he shook.
I created you, all of you.
Might be time for the icon, thank God, because I was starting to get worried about my potion situation.
Is mine to destroy.
Oh, when we get into space. Perhaps,
but we are no longer yours. Our flames are our own, and they burn as one!
Oh, sorry. There's like a black mark on my controller. I'm like, what the hell is that? Just trying to scratch it off. I don't like these white controllers for the PlayStation 5. They dirty too easily, I feel.
Have you learned nothing? Damned is the slave who would turn the scourge upon his master.
Hey, what's up, Daylor? Devil Trigger Astronaut. Seemingly so. I'm assuming you've already beaten this game. Otherwise, I wouldn't expect you to be here for the end of it. Warped right into that, jackass. Honestly, I can just barely make out what's happening. There is a lot of effects going on. Sometimes it makes it a little hard to tell. Not yet? Oh, dang it. Quit looking. I appreciate the visit regardless, but yeah, I think we're like just on the end of it. Thank God you didn't come in a few minutes earlier, because there was some heavy story stuff. Mostly this is just battles.
Yeah.
I don't know about that. Okay. At least I could dodge through it. Christ. I don't like those area of effect attacks that take up like all of the area. I know that the dodge can basically get you through anything, but still, it doesn't make me feel any better. That is a high number for that gauge. Doesn't amount to a whole lot, but it's a high number. He interrupted me during my charge attack. I don't think it did any damage against him, so it was just a waste, and now I have to wait for it to recharge.
Enough!
Seconds or something. I appreciate that lurk, Ikiri, but yeah, this is the very end of the game. I don't even know if you're listening. So I know you just started it. Definitely wouldn't want to be watching for too long. But I appreciate it. I took a big break on this game, too. It seems like there's a lot of people that are still in progress, which I don't blame them, but you know, kind of funny. Hey, we did it, maybe? No. There we go, okay, just needed like that one last hit. The rapture, you say? I'm just mashing the dodge button. Seemed to get me through. Now, we're kind of in the core. It would seem almost like we shouldn't be getting hit by those attacks, but I guess we still are, unfortunately. Too bad. What? I'm a Kairos? I don't even know what that is. But I remember it was bad last time it happened. Oh yeah, the big beam. Almost. Load up that scene, there's a little bit of lag.
How is this possible?
No. No.
Now there are two
my
of them.
My will is inviolable.
Oh, you stepped over my two of them line.
You're afraid. You always have been. From the moment the Blight exposed what you were, weak, you conceived us to prove otherwise. But the result shook you to the core. For in us you saw yourself, and realized we had the potential to be more than you could ever be. And so you turned your back on your creation. Your back on the world, like the coward you are.
You think you know me? You know nothing, Logos. Nothing!
But I might be able to pull up the lore thing, see what Logos is. Like a Sephiroth. Well, if you ever want to symbolize the end of the world, Sephiroth is usually a good visual marker for that.
Bathed in light, I stand above you, my rebirth complete. And you, for your defiance, shall pay the proper price.
Sounds a bit rehearsed.
Suffering. You have known none of these, but we have, so we know what they grant. They bring us together, and that makes us strong.
Alright.
My will be done.
This guy's still talking like he thinks it's part of the Bible. I could do that too, asshole.
Freeze,
You know what? Let me take this out. For that move. You know what? Here, while we're kind of doing things here, maybe I should use one of these. Shit. I did the wrong thing. I should have used the Garuda first. At least we got it in at some point. I was a little worried I wouldn't be able to get this dancing blade in thing, because that's what usually gets me my Zentatsuken gauge all the way up to level 5. This time it looks like we're going to be needing to use all of our abilities. There you go, Clive. Icon against icon. We'll match fire with fire. Doesn't help if I can't see what I'm doing. Oh, those weird light beams are the things that Barnabas was using against us with Odin. I guess he was primarily using three different icon abilities, and I was using the other three. Bahamut, Odin, and Shiva. Forgot to use the Garuda against him. Again. It seems like after he does that big move with whatever Odin ability he's using, gives me a little bit of free time. So that's the one to use it on. Actually, while we're doing this, I better use another stone skin. I'm sure that last one we used is all used up by this point. Dion there, but you know, Uncle Byron is fine too. That icicle right up his ass. Damn it, the stagger gate's rebuilt. Damn, one of these. ever-expanding area of effect. Lucked out on that one. Zantatsuken should still be at level 5, so I don't need to activate that move. I can actually get a couple free hits in with some abilities there. Previous time I've just done that move, it didn't have splash damage. I always dodge into that one a little bit too early. Oh, this one again so soon? This is a big move. Come on. Slowly gaining on me. Come on. Doesn't do a ton of damage, but at least it freezes time for a second. This should freeze the stagger gauge, so I might as well use it to get what I can in. Oh boy. push that sword up, lop his head off. Leaning in so damn close. Oh, good. I recharged my health.
So sure of your place atop the world, you refuse to acknowledge those below. You chose to remain alone. And so you shunned the one thing that could have made you stronger. Pushed away the hands that could have raised you higher.
I do not need you, you or anyone.
And that is where we are different. I could not have made it here on my own. I carry with me the hopes and dreams of my brothers, my sisters. And it is they who will give me the strength to end your reign.
I mean, they mostly just took their powers
I
and then,
cannot end.
Use them for himself. Zen Setsuken. I think that might have finished it.
The world you seek is but a fantasy.
A Final Fantasy, perhaps.
The only fantasy here is yours. And we shall be its final witness.
I mean, that's close enough to a title drop. Go, goddamn Arung.
I said it's over.
One final punch. Did I get anything out of that? No experience or anything? Probably should have switched out one of my accessories for something that was probably more battle-ready. I was thinking about that, too. I'm like, do I need the experience? And I'm like, well, if the boss battles give me anything, they might actually level me up for one of the final battles. Oh, well. Exactly.
But I doubt it will be pretty. A sorry tale of sin and suffering, hardship and pain.
And it was for this that you fought so fiercely? Why?
It's who we are. We fight. We survive. We endure. We don't need a reason. We are imperfect creatures. When we stumble, we reach for a shoulder to lean on. When we fall, we stand back up. We see the horizon, ever out of reach, and still we march on. Certain the answers lie just beyond it. Because that is our way.
Congratulations. Relish. this victory, knowing that you have but delayed the inevitable. Your world is already dead. May you enjoy an eternity on its blackened husk.
Thank you. I will. Yeah, I was always looking at his eyes, and I'm like, what is going on with them? I thought they were just, like, black around the pupils. But, like, there's flesh all the way into the pupil area. It's very strange. It's almost like a chameleon. But they don't telescope out. They, like, sink in. Thank you. It's a battle hard fought. You know, still, I don't think that final battle was as hard as Odin. Barnabas was a bit much. Because as we recall, I used all my items with him. Weird looking baby.
It seems Ultima's power was too great for this vessel all along. But while I have it, perhaps I can use it to set things right. And see Ultima's legacy. Bearers, dominance, crystals, magic. Consigned to the flames. Even if it means the end of me.
I guess he broke the crystal. The island shattered and he washed up ashore. Oh, look at his fingertips. I was wondering when that was going to come into play. On the one hand, I kind of wondered if, maybe the dominance. Oh. Boy, that progressed fast. We're immune to the petrification, but. Thinking back, I think Jill and Cid, the original Cid, all had. That condition worsening. So I wondered when it would manifest with Clive, but since he was like the all-powerful dominant that could absorb all the other powers, I was wondering if maybe he was immune. But he's pretty much been covered head to toe. With every character name, there's like a long, fairly long list of people. Maybe there's several different language tracks. There's got to be an English and a Japanese dub, and then maybe a motion capture, and then I think maybe for some of the time skip people, there'd probably be one, but it seems like there's two or three extra. I just don't know what they'd be. But that's a big cast.
If you need a rest, I can take it.
I'll hold you to that.
The world's yours now. Yours to do with as you please. That's what Sid wanted. That's what they both wanted.
Journey end.
Tsuki akari yanagi ga yureru watashi wa robo no tsubu de.
Farewell to fate. Anata no sugata hitsuji wo kasoeru yo. I guess here are the real credits. Song sounds like something. Like some of those notes sound like something else, but I can't quite put my finger on it. You know, it's kind of funny. Thinking about it, most of the Final Fantasy songs, or, well, I should say, most of the Final Fantasy, like, end theme, like the credit staff roll themes, once you get to a certain point, they do start to incorporate vocals quite a bit, but, like, usually, like, all the cases I could think of, there are always a female vocalist, so it's kind of funny, where you have this one where it's, like, a male artist. Let's put that on mute for a second, though. We'll discuss this game a bit while the credits are rolling, as we usually do. I'm imagining this one's going to go on for a while, since it's a Final Fantasy game. These games are usually pretty big. That was a pretty big ride we just went on. This was one I don't know that I was necessarily looking forward to it as much as other games that have come out this year, but it was a big one. I mean, when a mainline Final Fantasy game comes out, it's like, that's something that turns most people's heads, even if they're not necessarily, you know, interested in the series. It's like, oh, Final Fantasy, it's a big one. It's a huge, huge series. So I knew that I was going to at least get it. I wasn't sure how I was going to play it. To be quite honest, I don't remember if we talked about this before, but the past two mainline Final Fantasy games, not necessarily been my cup of tea. I've played them to the finish. It's Final Fantasy 13, Final Fantasy 15. I don't count 14 because that's online. But those two games were not that great. Every time we get a chance to talk about and shit on Final Fantasy 13, I usually take an opportunity to, if I had my problems with that game. 15, while I don't wholly think it was a terrible game, there was a lot that I didn't like with that one. And I stuck it through to the finish, which I'm actually kind of surprised by, because that definitely seems like a type of game that I would have given up on, especially nowadays. But when it came out, I don't know, it was just one of those things where I'm like, it's Final Fantasy, gotta finish it. So, for the longest time with these past two games, it's always seemed like the directors of Final Fantasy, and I don't know specifically which one does which and who does what, But it always seems like they're trying to cater to an audience that they don't have. Which is fine, I get that people want to do that. You want to try to bring in new eyes to your product, but at the same time, they make a lot of choices and changes with the series that just don't appeal to me, and it seems like they don't appeal to a lot of the core fan base that existed with the Final Fantasy series. So it's like they're almost forced me out. The reason why I wasn't really looking forward to this one was just because of the last two games don't think were that great. So I wasn't even cautiously optimistic. I was mostly just cautious about this game. But when the gameplay trailers were coming out, I said, that gameplay looks pretty good. There's a lot of people that made mention, as we've talked about during the stream, it looked like a Devil May Cry-ish type action-oriented game. And I said that it looks fun. And I said, I don't know how much of it is going to be completely interactive, because even though, like, Final Fantasy VII Remake, for instance, was more in line with, like, an action base, there's still something about it where everything doesn't quite feel responsive. There's, like, a bit of an automated feel. So it's still, like, blurring that line between, like, an RPG where you don't really have full control over the inputs and an action game where you kind of do. But fortunately, they've decided to ditch that completely, and I wonder how much the next Final Fantasy VII Remake is going to change based on that fact. Because I would really like more of a gameplay style like this, as opposed to what we got with Final Fantasy VII Remake. It's not bad with the remake, but at the same time, like I said, it's just not a really doesn't feel like a fully responsive game where your actions are clearly reflected by the prompts that you're pressing. Sometimes there's a little bit of give and take or some delay or something like that. So the gameplay was what was really attracting me to this game, and it's really what held me through most of it, because, as I've said before also, the story didn't quite grab me at first. Elements of it did, but not entirely. But the gameplay was so slick, and it felt fun to play, and I liked the new additions that they would gradually give you, and, you know, the boss battles being exceptional, that it really just kind of was more addicting to see, you know, what else would happen in terms of the gameplay. I wanted to fight more battles, I wanted to fight more bosses. And it got fun, and that's probably the prime aspect of this game that I think was really what stood out the most, was mostly that gameplay. So in terms of gameplay, I'm glad that they finally worked out something. I wonder if it's going to change by the time they get to, if they get to, they're going to, but when they get to the next mainline, you know, single player Final Fantasy game, maybe it's going to be 17. Maybe 17 is going to be an online, I don't know. But I kind of hope that maybe they stick with this a bit, just because I do like that action-oriented gameplay. I would like it to be a little bit more RPG-ish. This game does not feel like an RPG. I really don't think you could classify it as one. I'm not sure if people do, but people always think of Final Fantasy as being, you know, the classic JRPG series. There's not a whole lot going on that I could consider an RPG. Not a whole lot of choices you can make, and granted, you know, when it comes to most of the Final Fantasy stories, there's not a whole lot of choice in terms of the story. You can't really affect the outcome of things that are going to happen, but sometimes you get little choices as to, you know, how story might branch off in certain aspects, or, you know, even changing up your party, things like that. There's more than just, like, selecting which abilities you unlock, and even with that, in this game, it's like you can double back and redeem all your experience points and just choose some other, you know, points and stuff, so it's not really, it feels like you're ever locked into anything. Kind of like the world is your oyster in terms of all the abilities and whatnot. So it doesn't feel like an RPG to me. Very, very minor RPG elements, but boy, compared to what Final Fantasy used to be, this is something entirely different. And, you know, they, like I said, they're always trying to garner that new audience. Some try to appeal to an audience that they don't have, and in turn, I think they shunned away a lot of their existing audience. So it's almost like they're trying to build it up again from what they've lost over time. But maybe people have been attracted to this game. I hear that, I think, 3 million copies sold. Not moved, but sold, and for a platform exclusive. That's not terrible. It's not really all that bad. So, seems like they've been doing okay. Response to this game seems like it's been pretty solid. I think the gameplay is a lot more polished than some of the previous Final Fantasy games. I would have liked it, I mean, if you could do a little bit more with it, if there was a little bit more choice and option as to, you know, what you could build. Like, maybe you could build up to a different class or something like that, as opposed to, but, you know, the whole summon thing was a big part of it. I guess summons were kind of like classes. I don't know. It's hard to kind of determine what they could have done differently. But, yeah, having a bit more of an RPG element, I think, would have made it a little bit more fun. Something else I could do different, because a lot of this game felt very locked in. But that aside, the core gameplay of it was pretty dang good. And that being said, some of the additional stuff, we've talked about the side quests aspect of this game, sucked for the most part. Very bad. Talking to one person, and they tell you to go talk to somebody else, and you have to go get an item at X location, or defeat an enemy at X location, and then go back to the original person that you talked to. Basically boils down to most of the side quests. The sense of exploration in this game is not great. There's really not a whole lot of areas that are all that interesting to look at. Overall, in the grand scheme of things, it's like, wow, that looks over pretty over there in the distance, but you can never, like, walk up to anything. You can't discover hidden paths. Even, like, a lot of the treasures and stuff that are on the ends of the map aren't worth getting. You know, there's accessories that might boost some of your abilities or reduce cooldown times or something like that, but they're not really that great. Crafting, very limited supply of things that you can make. You know, it's like once you reach a certain level, then, you know, if you've been collecting crafting supplies for most of it, then you can unlock the next tier weapons, and that's basically it. So not a whole lot of incentive to do extra stuff, unless you're just a completionist. But yeah, really all the side quests and all the little extra tidbits, crafting materials, very shallow and not much to it and not very fun to play at the end of the day. As far as the side quests go, I mentioned it before, but the ones that had actual characters behind them and weren't just like stock NPC stuff, a little bit more interesting, especially if they had some cutscenes or something tied to it and had something a little bit more crafted. More of that would have been better, or maybe even less of the NPC stuff and just stick with the character side quests entirely. Would have made for a much better experience, I think, for if you were looking to do extra bits. As far as like the pacing in this game, I mean, we could delve into the story, talked about it, the beginning of this game, highly derivative. You know, we could talk about Game of Thrones and stuff. And I know some people are bugged for whatever reason, like, well, you compare it to Game of Thrones. But there's a lot of story elements that are very similar to it. And I get it, and you know, the bitchy mother or the stepmother and, you know, the backstabbing nature of things and having usurped thrones. Tales as old as time. It's not like Game of Thrones invented these things. Certainly not. But Game of Thrones was the most recent popular example. And not only that, the devs of Final Fantasy themselves at Square Enix have mentioned Game of Thrones repeatedly. So I think it's an apt comparison for people that want to make that kind of comparison. I mean, you go back to the, you know, 12th century of Amleth for story elements that were incorporated into this game, but like I said, more popular, more recent example, Game of Thrones would be the most prominent one that you could probably point towards. So a derivative in a lot of different senses, you know, takes up some major elements from some major different stories and puts them into a bit of a blender. But it's kind of funny, like with all the Game of Thrones stuff and all the political things going on, the usurping and the backstabbing, all that sort of like falls by the wayside. And I guess, you know, when there's a world-ending cataclysm, some of that stuff would kind of fall apart, but it seemed like they were setting up so much. I would have expected Clive's mother in particular to kind of more stick out the story through to the end. But it was like, once you got like to the halfway point of the game, it's like everything focused from one thing to another. So it was almost like two different stories. You had the, you know, Clive breaking free from his bearer servitude. It's almost like a Spartacus type story, or maybe not Spartacus, maybe, what am I thinking of? It's the movie with the chariots. I'm trying to think. I'll look it up. Movie with chariot racing. 50s. I think it was the 50s. Ben-Hur. That's the one I'm thinking of. Kind of like Ben-Hur, just a bit. So it's like you have like this Clive trying to break free and come up from his servitude upbringing for most of his adult life and trying to make something of himself and get back at his mother and the empire and all that. And then once the stuff with Ultima comes out, and then it turns into a kind of different story where they have to prevent the end of the world from an evil god that's looking to destroy everybody. So, yeah, two stories for the price of one, I suppose, but it feels kind of weird where some elements just outright ended, and it almost kind of felt abrupt, I don't know. But maybe not, considering this was a bit of a longer game. Pacing-wise, sometimes this game was a bit of a chore. I did not like some of the pacing that happened. This was more, I guess, a problem like the first two-thirds of the game. It's like you'd go and you'd do a major event, major boss battle, go take out a Mother Crystal or something like that, and then it's like everything comes to a halt. It's like they're not actively looking for the next step. It's like, mess around. Go muddle around here for a second and, you know, go pick flowers in a field, and maybe by the time you're done with that, then we could progress with the storyline. Okay. That happened a lot, and wasn't the greatest, you know. I started to see the pattern eventually. Like, oh boy, you know, this is going to be a grandiose thing that we're going to do, and then everything is just going to come to a halt, and it's going to be extremely boring after we finish up with it. So it did work out that way for most of the game. I think like the last third of the game, pacing started to pick up a little bit, and we didn't have to do that quite as much, or at least if we did, it wasn't as frequent. But still, I don't know, I feel like a lot of that meandering could have been nixed from the game. No need to inflate game time like that. I don't need to go pick out random things or deal with NPCs that I'm never gonna see again. I could trim the fat just a bit, and I felt like the pacing of the game would have worked out a lot better. Visually, the game was stunning. I don't know if it's the best graphics I'd ever seen, but we talk about how much of a spectacle this game is. Sometimes to a fault, it's like a lot of the icon battles, so bright and colorful, but there's almost too much going on at times. It's sort of hard to focus. But, you know, if you got the power, I feel definitely like they wanted to display the power of the platform they were on. And it's like so many particle effects and other visual splendors that were going on for most of the game and the cutscenes. It's like they built it up. The boss battles were cool. And fortunately, I would say it would have been more of a detriment if the combat wasn't so good in this game. But it was, so I felt like it was, I don't know, the more deserved when you have like the visual flurry and a bunch of things going on, and you have a lot of these cutscenes with QTEs, basically. Just because the combat was so good, and it felt like you're actively doing something and it actively takes skill to do, and then you get a little treat once you finish a big segment of it, and then you could watch a bit of a cutscene for a second. Also fun with the boss battles. I mean, I keep talking about the boss battles, the best part of this game in terms of the gameplay. It's what had the most variety, for sure. I mean, every time you do a boss battle and you launch into an icon instance, you know, you never know what kind of gameplay type you're going to conjure up, because we had, like, the rail shooters in the air, and, you know, the basic quick time events, like the huge scale stuff, and the sort of bullet hell type instances, and you never knew what you were gonna get. You might see a pattern with the type of gameplay and having to dodge moves and stuff, but for a lot of the bigger stuff, it was you're always guessing as to what was gonna happen, and I felt like it actually kept the gameplay fresh. So very good aspect in terms of that. I felt like all that was pretty well balanced. Music wise, I don't know why they went with synthetic instruments. Synthetic band always sounds horrible. And I could ignore it in some instances. Fortunately, and for whatever reason, it sounds like they had a live chorus. I don't know if that maybe it was AI or that too was synthetic, but it sounded a hell of a lot better than synthetic instruments. I do not like synthetic orchestras. They sound like shit. So I would have liked it if they spent a little bit more money. But the compositions were great. They do reuse a lot of the same boss battle music and a lot of the, like, you hear that one tune that was just playing a second ago during the credits, but it's really good. The soundtrack is really well composed, I will give it that, even if it doesn't always sound as great as it could have, with a live orchestra in place of synth, The compositions were great. And even though they did reuse a lot of the boss battle music, and you hear it a lot, especially if you're going after the Barks, because the Hunts will consistently reuse the same thing, and you know, you get the same thing with mid-boss battles. But I think with every major boss, like all of the icon fights and some of the major stuff when you're going after the Mother Crystals, all of those, I'm pretty sure, had unique boss themes, so they weren't skimping on the variety of music, and it, you know, certainly comparing it to previous Final Fantasy games. I know we love the boss battle themes of Final Fantasy 7, 8, and 9, for instance, and even those prior to that, but they reuse boss battle music all the time. And then maybe when you get to the very end of the game, you have a little bit more variety with the very final bosses. But I think with every major boss in this game, they all had some unique track playing at some point. So it was nice that they gave it that much variety, because they certainly could have done less. And maybe that's why they didn't end up using a live orchestra, is because they ended up doing, you know, something pretty big. But at the same time, it's like other Final Fantasy games have used live orchestra, I'm pretty sure. I think Final Fantasy 13 and 15, for instance. 12 was still using synth, I'm pretty sure. But definitely by the time you get to 13, I remember 13's soundtrack was being remarkable. I'm pretty sure all that was live. That's the best part about that game. I'm pretty sure 15 was as well. I'm not 100% certain. It's been a while since I played it, but pretty good. And I enjoyed the music in this game. I wish they would have kept up the trend of doing live. Oh, well. I don't know that I could think of too much else. I like the setting of things for the most part. Summons are always cool in the Final Fantasy universe, but rarely do they take the meat of the story. A lot of times it's just basically a glorified attack in a lot of Final Fantasy games, and they don't always have a whole lot to do with the story. Sometimes, like I'm thinking of Final Fantasy XII, for instance, you know, they have to unlock summons in order to get certain powers, but then there are like additional ones that could be gotten that really don't mix in well with the rest of the core story. Final Fantasy 15, while not wholly focusing on summons, they do play a big part. But I don't know that there's been a game where the summons have taken like such a front seat to the story since maybe Final Fantasy 6. Because, you know, that with that one, I forget what they were. Were they Eidolons in that one? Or was that... I think Eidolons were 9, but they might have been in that one as well. Whatever the summons were in that one, they had a bigger part to play in 6. And, yeah, usually otherwise they... Well, I guess, you know, thinking about it, they like I said, they usually incorporate them in some extent. Some more than others. 9, 10. I guess I shouldn't say that they're glorified attacks in all the cases, because a lot of times they do have some kind of story element, but still... They're more used as strictly a source of power as opposed to being like the embodiment of somebody. So that being the case with this one, where they were like the icons were the people, the characters of the game, it felt a little bit more unique. Like I said, really haven't had something like that since 6. Even though, you know, in the Final Fantasy 9 and 10, somewhat in 12 and 15, you had certain character traits applied to them, but they still weren't as fleshed out as being like actual characters, the main characters in the game. So it was kind of a unique aspect, or at least one we haven't seen in a while. So that was kind of cool. Speaking of the characters, I felt like a lot of the characters were pretty well done. This might be one of the best Cids. If I'm thinking, is he the best Cid that we've had? Because we've had Cids that were, you know, have a lot of personality. What's up, Relo? Thank you for joining in. We've had Cids that were, you know, part of the main story usually, or even a part of the characters that you get to choose from your party, but this Cid was really cool. And having a smooth, rustic voice helped with that, I feel. It's a bit of a shame that he wasn't in the entirety of the game, but... I don't know. I guess when you get a B-list actor, you probably can't expect him to hang around for hundreds of hours of dialogue. still, props to them. And he went out like a damn hero. You know, I was sort of feeling it coming too. I'm like, probably not going to see him for too long. Something's going to happen. But he went out so cool that, you know, I couldn't be upset. Even though it was sad to see him go. Sad to see him leave the story, but he certainly went out with a bang. The story, as we said, very derivative. Didn't always grip me. I feel like the characterizations were strong enough, though, that sometimes I would sort of get swept up into the story. The final moments with Joshua and Clive, I'm like, oh. Kind of felt for him there. Just because those two characters had been built up so well, I think. Some of the characters, not so much. I felt like Jill could have used a little bit more. Maybe not even screen time, but maybe just a little bit more depth to her as a character. But I suppose you could only do so much. So still, I feel like I'm just like thinking Final Fantasy usually does its characters pretty well. There's exceptions. A big one being like Final Fantasy 13, for instance, where I thought everybody was annoying. But with this one, I get worried about Clive every now and again, especially towards the beginning of the game. And I suppose when you think about the events that are happening, it's probably justified, but it felt like he was getting a little bit too emotional. There were too many times almost, I felt like, where he was just breaking down and screaming and crying and stuff. Calm down. Control yourself, Clive. It's all right. Like I said, is it justified? Probably. Eventually they did tone it down. I was a little bit worried that it was something that would be continuous throughout the entirety of the game. Like Clive would just like start bursting out, crying and screaming every opportunity he got. But they did calm it down, and finally, you know, those last moments with Joshua is justified for him to, you know, kind of have an emotional outburst there. But they kept him, they sort of polished him up a little bit. I think by the time that he took on the mantle of Cid, that was when he sort of, his demeanor kind of changed a little bit, and he was a little bit more mature and pushed through a lot of the pain and the suffering and whatnot. So I do think that they ended up doing a good job with him. Is he the best, like, protagonist as I've seen some people calling him? Maybe not. I mean, the Final Fantasy games are always criticized for their main protagonists either being too cold and emotionless, although sometimes completely warranted. You just have to look at the full picture of the story and not just pick out key moments. But yeah, it's the Final Fantasy protagonists always have been criticized for being too one-dimensional or bland or whatever, and I feel like you get a pretty complete package with Clive, so maybe he'd probably be up there. I don't know if he'd ever fall into the fan favorites. I'd probably have to give this game some time to breathe, but still pretty good. I don't know where I'd rank it in terms of all the Final Fantasy games. It's certainly been better than the previous two that we've had, I will say that much. Will it stand up there with the greats? I don't know. It has its ups and downs. I do think gameplay-wise, this is the best decision and the best polish they've given the Final Fantasy games in a long time. So I'm happy with how they approached it this time around. But still, yeah, I don't know. Everybody's always sighing and heaving at the thought of, you know, like stuff like Final Fantasy VII being among the greats. I don't know if it's as good as that. Probably not. Just because I think as a whole package, VII is, it feels a little less up and down. There's less cons, I feel like, with something like with that game. My favorite is always going to be 9, I think. 9 and 10 and 12, 7, 6... Those are always ones that I favor, but we'll see. After several months pass by and I've got some time to reflect on this one, I'll determine as to where its placement is going to be, but it's pretty good. I'll give it that much. And again, I do think it's a step up from the previous attempts to adapt the Final Fantasy mainline series into a new realm of gameplay. So good on you, Square Enix. You did something good. But otherwise, I think that might be it. I don't know that there's anything else I can necessarily think of to talk about at this point in time. You know, maybe. It usually happens that a couple weeks will go by, maybe even a month or something like that, and I'll think of other stuff. I'm like, damn. Should have mentioned that while I was doing a little wrap-up during the credits, but a lot of this stuff is going to be hindsight, so it'll come to me eventually. Maybe in some random stream I'll bring up some additional points that I didn't think of or forgot to mention. We haven't been talking about it for a while. These credits have been rolling for quite some time. Though, end of the day, pretty good game. I do think they did a pretty good job with it. One of the better games I played on the PS5 as well. I feel like we've been doing it a lot, off and on. I think probably since Ragnarok came out, there's been a handful of games that I've streamed off of this thing. Might even be, I'm trying to think, would it be the best? Because I don't have too many PS5 games, but what have we done on stream? We've done Ragnarok, which is alright, but I feel like kind of overstayed its welcome for a bit, and I had issues with the story in that game. Some of the pacing with it. We did... what's it? I can't even think of the name of it. The Dead Space spiritual successor. The hell was the name of that game? No, I don't remember. Well, that one. Not that great. Interesting gameplay design. It wasn't as bad as a lot of people were making it out to be, but boy. Fell short of something. Something was missing from that game. Can't quite put my finger on it. I think a lot of the level design was part of it, too. Needed something else. Needed a different point of view for that one to be any good. We did Ghost of Tsushima. A really good game. Beautiful visuals. But that was another game where I felt like it happens with a lot of those open world games, where they just go on for a long time. There's so much additional stuff that I do end up getting burnt out on it. Despite the fact that I said, you know, side quests suck and stuff with this game, Final Fantasy 16, I will say that I don't think I ever really felt burnt out on it. It's a good length for a game, for a long game. Those open world games like Ghost of Tsushima, though, those go on forever. A little bit too long, in my opinion. And then, what do we do? Jedi Survivor? I like Jedi Survivor a lot. It's a damn shame that the performance was so horrendous. But that game was leaps and bounds better than Fallen Order. And I do think that it did a lot right. So, I was actually pretty pleased with Survivor. And maybe even in terms of gameplay, I might have preferred that one a little bit more, but I don't know. I'd need some time to think on it. I don't think I upped the volume any. Hold on. Oh. Careful,
every
kids.
Time.
Will you light it?
Yes, Mother.
I was going to say, is he going to use magic or flint?
Come on. If only I had the flames of an icon.
Icon? Have you been reading that silly story again? Magic belongs in fairy tales, and fairy tales don't boil kettles. You see? Well done. Now, be a good lad, and play with your brother until supper.
Come on! Hurry! Hurry! Right! Right, let's play the saint in the sectary. No, I don't want to be Madu. What do you want to play then? War of the Icons. Again? Right. And I get to be a freak. Right, I'm the older brother. because Bahamut says so.
But where one journey ends, go on. Another begins. Falling Star. All right. Well, that's your post-credit scene. Final Fantasy written by Joshua Rosfield. I wonder what sort of connotation that has. Either that means that... I mean, here's the thing. We saw at the very end... Right at the end, after he defeated Ultima, Clive walked up to Joshua and sort of what I assume was what he did was use the Phoenix Flames on him. It made him look like he recovered because he wasn't covered in blood and he didn't have the big cavity in his chest. So I thought he healed him for a second, but then, you know, the place started to crumble and he used his ability, Clive used his ability to shatter the life stream or the aether flood or whatever that was. So either everything that happened was just a fantasy written by Joshua Rosfield and, you know, none of what happened had come true, or I don't think that's it. I think maybe just because we saw that brief moment where Clive used the Phoenix Flames on him, he might have resurrected him, or at least maybe Joshua wasn't fully dead at that time, and the Phoenix Flames just brought him back, and he survived Origin crumbling, much like Clive did, because Clive was seen on the shore, and he went on to write a book, and generations lived after that. Maybe that book has just been in circulation for a very long time. It's kind of like a Bible of sorts. And, you know, magic has left the land. There's no aether, but people survived and life goes on. I don't know. Something to think about. Sort of interesting. New Game Plus. Now available from the title screen. Optionalizing to start a new game with player item data carried over previously completed playthrough. Gameplay mode Final Fantasy is now available for use exclusively with New Game Plus. Yeah, what is Final Fantasy mode? I saw that there was a trophy attached to that, but I don't know what it was. You have increased enemy strength, increased player level cap to 100. I don't know what the level cap was previously. I wonder if it was 50, because we were getting up there. There are new gear and items and mode exclusive content. This mode is recommended for players who wish to test their limits. That might be me. All right, well, one of those games where I wasn't sure if I was actually going to play it in its entirety on stream, but end of the day, I'm glad I did. It was a fun game. Had its down moments, but overall, I enjoyed it quite a bit. It did take a while to get through, of course. There was periods where I wasn't streaming that much because it's been so goddamn hot, but fortunately, it seems like the hotter weather has been dying down just a tad, so maybe we will get back into our regularly streamed schedule. But yeah, we are done with this one. That's another new game in the year that has been completed on stream, so yay. It's a lot of games this year, and I'm somewhat surprised because it's not usually something that I tend to do, but glad we got another one, another feather in the cap. And yeah, we are probably it. Thank you. Final Fantasy complete. Yeah, we are, I guess, looking for Armored Core 6 now. I think it's the next one down the line. Well, that and another game, but I'm not going to speak on that one. That one's going to be a surprise when it comes out and I'm actually going to stream it, because it's going to be horrible. And I don't want to tip anybody off that I'm actually going to be playing it. Oh, it's going to be bad. It's going to be bad. That one's coming out in August sometime, though. I don't remember if it was mid or late August. I think it comes out after Armored Core 6, though, so we might still be in Armored Core territory. I do want to get to Armored Core Master of Arena, though, so we'll probably be looking at that. What else in the meantime, though? I don't really have too much of an idea. I'm sure we will come up with something, but yeah, it's looking like our schedule is going to be freed for the time being. So definitely going to be doing some Armored Core in the near future. And what else in between now and when Armored Core 6 comes out? Not too sure, but there's plenty of games I could be streaming, so I'll decide in the meantime. But for now, we're going to end it. Thank you guys for watching. Appreciate it as always. And yeah, I will be back probably as soon as tomorrow. I don't know 100% if I actually will, but it's a possibility. And yeah, we'll probably be doing some Master of Arena, so stay tuned for that. But you guys take care. Have a good night. Thanks for sticking around. Thanks for watching the finish of Final Fantasy 16, and on to the next one. Until then, take care. Have a good night.